Okay, it's project time. Let's do some brainstorming.
Yeah, that sounds like fun.
We've already done the big brainstorm, but I like some of the ideas that we've done. Let's try to narrow some of them down.
Mm-hmm.
I really liked that those why questions. And somebody had said, you know, to ask a question about whether the mice and humans see things the same. It seems like we could turn that into a why question somehow.
Okay. What do you mean they see the same?
Okay. Good point.
Same way that, like, you're asking whether my red is similar to your red?
Yeah. Yeah, like that.
I mean, this is a problem. It's an old philosophical question. We would need something more. I mean, you and me and Athena, we could all see red differently.
But we'll name it the same.
What if I asked you, you can see this orange behind me, right?
Oh, yeah.
Is that orange to you?
Yeah, that's orange.
I thought it's orange too.
It's different than the next orange. Like, those two houses are a different orange. Do you think that they're both,
we can differentiate it, but maybe some people can't differentiate it.
I wonder if mice can.
How about what if we were to measure? Like, I could ask you and Athena each to see whether those oranges are different, and then I could ask you whether you can tell the differences. If you can tell the same differences from Athena, it means that at least you and Athena are seeing those sort of similarly, right?
That's interesting.
Yeah, that makes sense. Yeah. And then could we do that for mice,
do we
too?
Have any?
I mean,
yeah, that's probably.
Yeah, monkeys do that easily. Maybe mice in something different, not colors, some other stimuli.
Yeah, we have data on, like, we have some other visual stimuli, like orientations. Do you think humans are going to be the best? I bet you humans are going to be the best for this.
No, actually, humans are different from each other, too. Like, we Iranian, we are really bad in color, in naming colors, because we just, like, bump them together. So,
really?
Okay. Yeah. Watch
maybe mice are better than us, probably.
So if
we have to measure,
we can. So how would we measure it? Like, here we have two oranges. Like, let's say that I think they're different and you think they're the same.
I think so. What do you mean by the same? So we have to probably give them a range of, like, shades between different oranges, right?
Yeah, that's
and
true.
See how many of those you would call them orange or red, right?
So imagine I held up two different oranges and I ask you to tell me, you know, say which one is more red, or I hold up two oranges and I say, are they the same or different?
Mm-hmm.
Then we could do this across a whole set of oranges, or, as you were pointing out, if we want to use the mice data set, maybe we do it with orientations.
So I want to get back to the why question. I mean, we can ask this, like, who's best, but maybe the best one of us is the best possible. Like, there's somebody who's the best in the whole world, or maybe everybody is, like, once they get good enough, that's as good as it gets. How good do you think it's possible to do here? How would we even start that?
I see. You are meaning that, like, there are different levels of difficulty, and then the brain would just, like, deal with them differently? Or...
Okay, so I remember that we're going to talk about two things that might be important. And I read a little bit about just the idea. So we have Bayesian approaches, right, which allow us to see how well you could integrate information. And there's these ideas of normativity, like what's the ideal or the best thing or the optimal thing to do. I think we're going to talk about optimal control, for example.
Mm-hmm.
So, all right, let's think about, could we figure out what the best possible discrimination would be, or the best possible ability to tell the difference between the colors?
But
I mean, if you
this is best according to who?
If you, like, zoom in on that, there's probably some point where even the computer couldn't tell them apart, right? Like, it's just two different pixel values or two pixel values that are the same. I don't know if we'd reach that, but, like, there's some limit somewhere,
you're saying,
right?
That, so our brain receives this sensory input, and then something might be really, really too weak to even evoke any response. It's just like, it's like a noise.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah,
exactly.
Well, I was going to say the retina at the end of the day is taking bits of light, right? So at some point, maybe it can't tell the difference anymore. There's just not enough of it. Or maybe there's noise in the retina, right? So even if it is getting some light, it can't tell the difference between that light and not light because it's noisy.
It might depend on how bright the thing is, right? It might be that some kinds are easier to tell, or like if it's a small, if we're just looking and zooming in at a small patch, it might be harder to tell or easier. Could we, I imagine we could try to calculate that. We'd have to make some assumptions, but we could say, you know, this
is... We can, if the orientation, the contrast of the orientation, it starts to just like really go fade and become completely non-discriminatable, so we are basically changing the amount of the strength of the signal, real signal in the stimulus, right? And we can have a systematic way to change that.
Yeah.
Okay, I like this idea. So what you're saying is something like, if I get to the point where I can't tell the two orientations apart anymore, then it's sort of at the level of noise in the system because I can't distinguish them. But as the orientations get further and further apart, there must be enough signal there. And I guess the same thing would be true with color or contrast.
I'm actually envisioning a whole plot that we could do for this. We could like vary something and then see how easy it is to tell them apart. And then, you know, like I imagine.
Something should be really, really, really easy. And all of us should always say that this is always orange and this is always 45 degree orientation. But then it gets like kind of more complicated when we move it toward the noisier or weaker stimuli. Then it would just be a chance, right? We just like guess.
Yeah. So what you're saying is something like an axis, which is like probability of being able to distinguish, and the strength of the signal or the difference between the colors or the orientations.
That
sounds
great.
So we could just do that, right? We can just put up, you know, orientations that differ by small amounts or colors that differ by small amounts, and then we will get a curve, and we could get this curve for humans, each of us, or for different mice, and we could then compare them.
There might be data about that of animals. Like, I mean, I know that the Stringer data set is looking at orientations. We might be able to look at the...
But is there any behavior in that data set? I think it was one just there's no task, right?
That's true. I think the Steinmetz data set has a task.
Right, Steinmetz, exactly. Right.
Okay, yeah. So yeah, we can use that. Maybe that will have the data that we need. And then we could also relate the neurons to
right.
We could relate the neurons to the stimulus, or the neurons to the choice that the animal makes. So like maybe the animal isn't doing a good job from the image, but like it seemed, if you just treated the brain like the image, it's doing really well for its own brain image.
So you're saying that basically we could try to see how well different neurons are actually distinguishing between the two images?
Or all of the neurons together.
Okay.
I mean,
how would you do that? Like, what do you mean all the neurons together? Are neurons from different brain areas.
We could divide it into different brain areas too. That's true. Yeah. I was thinking that maybe you just like take an image of the... Like we just were talking about how we could distinguish two orientations or colors based on an image. But what if we just treat the neural activity like an image?
Okay. That's a good idea.
Interesting.
And then there's some noise in the neurons, right? We know that. And so maybe that limits how well the animal can do. And maybe it doesn't. Maybe like the noise is smaller than how hard the task is.
So do you think we will have all of these tools during the school that we can use to do all of these analyses?
We can try. I mean, we can see what we need. I think this is like a rich fodder for thinking about a project. I think we can make this happen one way or another. We can at least learn about some stuff.
Yeah, I mean, I think that we have all of the right questions sort of at a level where we should be able to go and ask which tools are going to be able to help us here, and then we can start reading up on it. After all, we can go look at some of the material from the later weeks if we need and start thinking about it.
Okay, so role playing over. That was fun. What we tried to do there was to demonstrate to you how you might take a concept from just the beginning of an idea of something that would be fun to do, or, you know, a topic, and start to turn it into something that you could analyze or mathematize by quantifying things. And so that's an exercise that you will be doing now as you take some of the big picture ideas that you've just developed and make them into something practical that you can start to work on. And this will take time. It will take time to go from a general idea and there will be false starts and dead ends. But talk to each other, talk to your mentors, talk to your TAs, and define yourselves some nice projects. And I think you'll have a good time doing that.
Ask questions on NeuroStars. Your mentors will be on NeuroStars, and they are willing to answer your questions on the forum. So just like, communicate with them or with the other students on NeuroStars.
Yeah. You have an enormous number of students worldwide, and everybody will be bringing some different experience. So if you ask questions, you're going to get an answer. And if you see somebody asking a question that you know the answer to, you should help them. And remember here, you have a set of data sets that you've seen, and you have a set of tools that you know you're going to learn about. And if you put together an idea, you can go to the TA and they will help you bring the tools that you may not yet have studied forward so that you can start thinking about them. And you're going to get conversations with mentors who are going to try to help you clarify and refine this process over the next weeks. Important, these questions are all big and they're all exciting, but we want to make sure that you actually get a project that you can do in the 2 weeks. So also ask, is this a project that I can actually do, or am I trying to, say, build a rocket and land it on Mars? There are some projects that may be a little too complicated for us to do in the 2 weeks we have. So good luck.
Yes. And cheers to the global scientific community that is having these discussions all the time. It's nice to have you a part of it. See you soon.